So my first question to Ben is, why did you decide to write a book?
Yeah, that's a good question. Well, because like you, I was out there figuring it out myself, and I had some hard times. And in those hard times, you know, I'd be sitting there, and it'd be early, like 2-3 o'clock in the morning, I'd be sitting there awake, going, why am I awake? And why am I sweating? And why am I cold? Well, I'm sweating. And why have none of the management books that I've read, like, why aren't they any help right now? And what I realized is the management books that I'd read all give you lots of instructions on how to not screw up your company. But once you've screwed up your company, there's no advice. And there's actually, you know, when you go through it, there's no actual way to not mess things up. Like, you can't do new things and not make mistakes. And so, like, how do you deal with those situations? How do you deal? And so I thought there needed to be a book about that.
Okay. Hey, so you're building a business. I'm going to go back to you building your company, Opsware. Explain to me the difference, as we all are in our way in this room, entrepreneurs, and want to learn from what you went through. The difference between courage and fear.
Yeah, so the very good question. So the difference between courage and fear, and this is something I actually learned from Mike Tyson, who learned it from Customato, is not what you feel. Because the hero and the coward feel the exact same thing. They're both terrified. It's what you do. And in these kinds of situations, you know, when you get into a really hard situation, you feel terrible. Like, you feel like you're going to throw up. You do not feel confident, like you know what to do. But it's finding the strength to do what you think is right, and do what you think is right even when everybody else thinks you're wrong. And the big thing is, you don't know you're right. You never know you're right. You just think you're right. And that's where you have to find the courage. That's where you have to find the courage to be a leader. And that's hard. Like, that takes practice. That takes development.
Is there any lead indicators on a person who wants to be an entrepreneur, individual thinks they're ready to be an entrepreneur and take on that responsibility, to know if you're ready to deal with courage, if you have the courage to do that in those moments? Is there any lead indicators prior to starting a business?
Well, big thing is, can you think for yourself? You know, that's the biggest thing. Can you think for yourself? Like, what is an idea that you had that everybody else thought was stupid that you went ahead and did anyway, is the big lead indicator. Like, do you listen to what other people think and then, like, pile on and make your answer what their answer is? Or do you kind of come up with your own way, kind of make your own way in the world? And one of the things we do when people come to pitch us now, you know, kind of knowing that, is if somebody goes and says, well, here's my idea and so forth, I always at some point go, well, you know, I don't think that's very smart. Like, I would do it this way. And if they agree with me, it's a very bad sign. Because they've thought about it for a long time. They came in, they presented it to me, well, and I get them off in 2 seconds.
But they're coming
seconds.
In for money, man. You got.
Well, they want to tell me what I want to hear. And I don't want people who tell me what I want to hear. I want people who tell me, like, how it is. And that's, you know, that's what it takes to run a company. Because what happens is, you get in a situation, and, you know, I was in a situation where I thought we were going to go bankrupt running the company the way we were. I thought the only way out was to basically change the business entirely and sell off the business I was in, or like all the customers, all the revenue, and take the technology and build a different company. And nobody thought that was a good idea. Like, my investors didn't think that was a good idea. My board didn't think that was a good idea. The people in the company didn't think that was a good idea. But they also didn't have the information that I had, and that is the nature of running a company. You have information that nobody else has. I knew, like, how bad things were to a degree that other people just didn't. And so I thought it was a good idea. And from a leadership perspective, if in that moment I had listened to them, like, that's the end of the company. But it would have been the easy thing to do, because everybody would have liked me a lot more, at least for a while.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's very hard, because you're kind of overcoming anthropology. Like, you know, people want to be liked, because it's like good for survival. Like, people don't want, you know, if you're liked and, you know, and you're in the tribe, like, nobody will like stab you in the back of the head, and that's good. You know, it's a positive quality. But if you're in a leadership position, you know, sometimes you have to do what's right and not what's popular, and those are the hardest things. Those are the things that require courage, and that's really what's required to run a company.
Okay, so you talk about courage and you talk about those tough decisions. I want you to take us in detail, because this is a very critical step when building a business. Let's talk about the firing process. So you've built this business, you have people working for you, everybody thinks it's going right, mm-hmm. or they feel some of the bumps. You have all the information on how bad it really is. Now you have to do layoffs. Let's talk about firing people.
Yeah. So I three layoffs I had to do in building the company. And so this is a difficult thing. Like, this is one of the most difficult things, and it's a very important stage of the company. And you can almost think of it, if you're have a mathematical background, it's like a boundary condition. And what you learn in math is, like, everything that happens in the middle is interesting, but the thing that happens at the boundary is even more interesting. And that's true in companies too. So first of all is the decision to do the layoff. And this is one where, like, nobody is going to like you for doing a layoff, one. And then most companies don't ever come back from layoffs. And there's a reason for that, and I'll get into that. And so if the company, if not laying people off means that you're gonna get yourself into real trouble and lose the company, then you kind of, you have to take a Confucian approach to it. The good of the individual has got to be subordinated for the good of the whole. And that's, like, it's a very, very hard thing to do, but it's something that you have to do, and it really is very related to layoffs and firings. And then once you decide to do it, you have to do it the right way. And this is probably even more important, because the message that you give to the people who are laid off is really also a message to the people who stay there. Because everybody who's going home has a relationship somewhere in that company with somebody who's staying, and they're gonna know what happened that day. And it's not gonna be something that they're gonna, like, forget next week or the next year or anything. A lot of stuff that happens at work, you forget tomorrow. But the day you get laid off or your friend gets laid off, you remember that, like, you will remember that for 10, 20 years, probably the rest of your life, because it's a dramatic day. And so how you behave is really important. And I got a lot of help on this from a friend of mine, Bill Campbell, had been through the process, and it was very good. The first thing is, like, you have to realize that you're laying people off because you fucked up. You made some set of decisions in the strategy for your business which got you into a place where, like, you hired more people than you should have, and now you gotta go backwards. And so, like, you've got to be clear on that first. You can't say, you know, we didn't need those people anyway. Well, we're going to lay off people, but, like, they're going to be the bad performers. No. Because, like, if they were bad performers, you would have fired them. You would have fired them in advance. You wouldn't have laid them off. And so you've gotten the company into that situation. And so then you've got to be true to the communication. And the first thing that I did is I said, look, I got all my managers together. I said, look, all of us, nobody's getting out of this. The first thing, if you think you're going home, calling in sick, you're going to have HR lay your people off, you're mistaken. Everybody here, including me, is going to sit here, and we're going to look everybody in the eye and say, look, here's the situation. We planned the business this way. The results came in that way. And as a result, you're going to lose your job. And it's not anything you did. Like, the reason for this action is not about you. It's about what we did, but, like, you are going to suffer the consequences. But we need to let them know that we're not making a judgment on them, and like we're going to be there, like we're going to be there as much as we can, like, and it's not everything, but we're going to be there to make sure that, to represent them and help them get to their next square. And then the thing that Bill told me that was, you know, quite profound is, then don't stay in your office after the layoff occurs. You go out there, you help people pack their stuff, you walk them out to their car, and you let them know you appreciated the time that they spent in the company. And by doing that, you give yourself a chance, because you really broke trust, which is the most important thing for a leader to have with their organization, is trust. Trust in the direction, trust in the competency. Because if you don't have trust, you're not going to be able to communicate, you're not going to be able to get on the same page, you're not going to be able to be effective. And so you violated trust by doing this layoff, and so you at least have to be honest about how you do it. And you know, from that, and you know, like I said, we had three layoffs when I was CEO, and not like proud or happy or think that any of them were good. But because we did them in at least the best way we possibly could, we ended up surviving. We ended up able to have a company after that. And actually the person, funny story, the person who runs the talent group for me now at Andreessen Horowitz, I wrote, when I first wrote about layoffs, she said, "Ben, you know what?" I said, "What?" She said, "You laid me off." And I said, "Get the fuck out of here. How did I lay you off? You know, you're my very best person. Like, how could I lay you off?" She says, "You know, look, I was a junior kind of recruiting coordinator, and like I got laid off in the first layoff." And I was like, "Well, why did you come back?" She said, "Because of the way you laid me off." I said, "That's a company I want to work for because they did it the right way. At least they didn't lie to me. At least they didn't blame me. At least they didn't hide from me when they took my job." And so that's a lot of what the layoff process is about.
Judging by the room, we have a lot of young entrepreneurs in the room today. What's the biggest advice, the best advice you would give to them? They're starting a business, they're building a business. What's the biggest advice you'd give to them?
So the biggest, that's a good question. You know,
that's why they're here, Ben. I mean, everybody's here so that they can walk out of here with something.
So here's the biggest advice. The track that I have in my head on entrepreneurship, you all know this. In this life, I strive for improvement, be your own guide, follow your own movement. And that's Heavy D, the great late Heavy D. You have to, this is yours. It has to be yours. It has to be the direction that you want to take on it. You've got to make the decisions. You cannot, there is going to be pressure from everywhere. There's going to be pressure from the people who work for you. There's going to be pressure from competitors. There's going to be pressure from people who give you money. There's going to be pressure from the press talking about you. And it's all going to feel like they're going to want you to be this, and they're going to want you to be that, and they're going to want you to go that way and the other way. But you're the person with the inspiration, you're the person with the knowledge, you're the person in the best position to direct what you're doing. And if you don't follow yourself, if you follow someone else, you're absolutely gonna fail. I can guarantee you that.
Over the past year, not 10 years, have you seen the role of the CEO evolving?
Yes. So the big change has been, when I was a CEO, the kind of rule in Silicon Valley was founder, inventor, invent the product, and then little boy go home and we'll bring in professional CEO to build the company. And I think that what's happened over the years is a few things. One, it turns out that those hired guns have a very, very, very short useful lifespan because, well, they can maximize the product cycle you're on, they can't get you to the next product cycle. And I like to feel that we had some leadership in this, but now people are much more open to the inventor running their own company, the founder running the company. And that's good news in a lot of ways because you can get to the next invention. It's bad news in that a lot of people come in with no skills, no management skills in particular, but also no leadership skills. And it's really, really, really important because you have, and this is one of the things that I hate that's developed in the culture is people go, oh, it's like an experiment. Well, it's not an experiment once you hire 30, 40, 50 people. It's not an experiment. It's their life, and they could have gone and got a high-paying job at Google or Facebook or somewhere, you know, with like free lunches that are delicious. And you've got them, you know, working for nothing, eating like bullshit ramen noodles and all that kind of stuff. And like, if you think it's an experiment, it's not an experiment for them. You got to take that seriously. You got to be a real leader. And you've got to, you know, it's up to you. To get them there. So I think like that's the big change is you've got people who can invent and reinvent, but not necessarily with the kind of management skills.
With, you talk about that some experience necessary.
Yes.
The notion of human resources, as you get bigger in a company, you hire HR. Do you use HR as part of, to enforce cultural compliance? What role does HR play in culture as you're building a company?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the first thing to understand is the head of HR is the CEO. And like if you think that you can hire an HR person and they're going to build your culture or make you good at management, like you're so wrong, I can't even describe it. That's not what HR can do. And the way to think about it is, it's like hiring a quality assurance team to build you a quality product. No QA can build you, they can tell you if your product sucks, but they can't put quality in. They can only tell you if you have it. And that's the way to think about HR and management and culture. So for example, like you go, okay, it's very important to me that when people come on board, they're well trained, they're ready to go, they get productive fast, and they're happy in their jobs. And I want to do that, and I'm going to put in some management practices to make sure that happens. How do I know my manager is doing that? That's something that HR can help you with. They can systematically help you figure out, like, is the company doing what you want it to do? But the design of what the company does and what the culture is and these kinds of things, that's got, you know, that has to come from the person running the company, because people working there, they want it to come from you. Like nobody, when I worked as an employee in a company, Steve, I know the same way, like the HR person isn't gonna tell you how to behave, right? Like that's gotta come from the person running the company is gonna say like, this is a behavior we want, this is a behavior we don't want. Mm-hmm. These are the values we have. These are the values we don't have. Like, that's not something that you outsource. That's not something you delegate.
How do you, you're going through the interview process. I don't know whether it's HR, you, yourself, in the interview. How do you screen talent for ambition?
Excellent question. So there's, ambition is a very important thing in a company. Because if you don't have ambition, if you don't have drive, it's really hard to go do something nobody's done before and build a great company. But there's really two kinds of ambition. And Andy Grove, who was the, many of you know him, he was the kind of pseudo founder and CEO of Intel for many years and one of the best kind of technology CEOs that we've ever seen. So there's two kinds of ambition. There's the right kind of ambition and the wrong kind of ambition. And in a company, the right kind of ambition is ambition for the company to succeed on its mission. And those people will do whatever it takes to make sure the company succeeds. And then the wrong kind of ambition is the ambition for me personally to succeed, and maybe sometimes in a way that's detrimental to the company. And it's really important when you put your team together that you understand what kind of ambition you're hiring. Because when you start out, you tend to get people the right ambition because they're the right kind of ambition. They're like at a startup, that, you know, you've got a little team, there's five people, and everybody's fired up. But when you start having success, right, like when you get to be kind of everybody's, oh, like that's a runaway hit. You're like, I really would like to join Pinterest. I would really like to get on this bandwagon. I would like to get in and get me some of that cash. then people start thinking about it in a different way. And that kind of thing, right, somebody's coming in and they're all about them and you're all about us. The funny thing about it only takes like a couple of people who are about them to really start to mess it up for all the people who are about us. So you've got to regulate that. You've got to look for it in the way they talk about themselves and what they've accomplished in the interview and like how they thought of themselves versus the people around them. Can they play on a team? Or are you getting somebody who's just going to, you know, optimize for them? Like I'm going to hire my own press person and they're going to promote me and I'm going to just be my person and then like the company, well, it is what it is, but like I'm going to make sure everybody knows who I am and that I'm associated with it. And so you got to be very, very careful about that. That's a key way that you can have real cultural drift if you're not careful.
Last question on this topic around people and company and hiring and firing, but you speak in the book about demotions. You speak about firing your friends and how to fire your friend, which is an amazing topic.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen, and I've dealt with this professionally, a successful demotion? And is that demotion title and salary? Or do you demote responsibility and title and still keep the same salary? How do you handle that?
That is a hell of a good question.
By the way, these questions are good because I deal with this on a regular basis and I'm kind of getting some advice here.
So, you know, the first thing about a demotion, and look, there's people you should fire and you should fire them. But when you get into things like demotions, it's usually around the following scenario, which is you had somebody and they were with you early and they got it done. I mean, like they helped you build the company. They went above and beyond. They were up late at night with you. You're in the office at 10 o'clock at night and they're there with you and they're doing it. But over time, they just don't adjust. The company changes and they don't change. But yet, because they did such a great job before, you put them in a very senior position to run an organization. But they just don't develop the skills to run the organization because they're so kind of just happy with how well they did at their old job that they keep doing their old job. That's the kind of failure mode on scaling is, I just continue, even though you gave me the bigger job, I keep doing my old job because I know that's what I was good at and that's kind of why I got the promotion, so I want to keep doing it. And I get a lot of positive reinforcement because I like have all the knowledge and everybody has to come to me and I'm like the guy. But now I'm like causing a bottleneck and I'm choking the company to death because I'm in this more senior position. And so now you're in a situation where you've got to either demote or fire your boy. Like this is your like friend. And how do you deal with that? Because to them, no matter how you phrase it, you're talking betrayal, right? You did this together. Now you're the kind of top of the organization and they're like, and you're like, okay, well, I don't need you in that spot anymore. And that's going to be a very, very hard and emotional thing for them to hear at all. And so this is kind of just like kind of situational analysis. When I wrote the post on this, I had a quote from one of my favorite Jay-Z songs with Too Short, and Too Short says, "It was cool when we had hella weed to smoke and you could buy a big house just to feed your folks." And
it was all good just a week
ago. I don't see how this side of you could be provoked. It was all good just a week ago. And it was like, and that's how they feel. It was like, what, you know, what just happened? Like, you're a backstabber, like you did this to me. And that's gonna be their first emotion when you go talk to them. And so their reaction on whether or not like that demotion is gonna work or whether it's gonna be a real problem is like how strong that feeling is, like how big the betrayal is. So the first thing that you can, all you can do is first you've gotta be committed. Like you cannot be talked out of it. Once you decide, you've gotta be decided. And if you know, they're probably part of the culture, they're probably important to the company and so forth. So the opportunity, if you really want to keep them, and probably the smart thing in general is probably to let them go, because usually you can't do that. And if it's like some executive you hired in from the outside, definitely fire them, don't demote them, because they've got an executive package, they've got executive equity, they've got executive salary. And like if you demote them, they're going to keep a lot of, and they keep all that stuff, then you know, that's not fair to the rest of the employees. And if you take it from them, which is a fair thing, boy, that doesn't ever work. Like, you go take somebody's money in their equity package, they're not going to be happy, because you just, like, you know, you emasculated them, or if they're a woman, what's the phrase for that? But anyway, like, you can't take somebody's respect and expect them to be the same person in your organization. So you're better off just, at that point, you part ways. But if it's somebody that helped you build the company and they're embedded, like, this is part of the team, that's a more complex situation. It's got subtleties to it. So you have to sit them down and you have to really be honest with them and say, look, you were great. I put you in this new role because you were so great. You didn't learn it. And now it's just a problem for the whole company and you're holding us all back. And so the two things we can do is, like, if you're not in agreement with that assessment and you and I aren't on the same page of what just happened, then, like, you should go and, like, let me help you, because, like, I know what you can do and I'm going to help you go do it again. But, like, you can't do that here, because, like, we're just at odds about your capability. If you do agree with it, then let's find something that you can do in the company that you're capable of doing, and, you know, that we can use, and that, like, because you're so part of the culture and everybody cares about you so much and you have so much knowledge about what we do here, that's invaluable. It's so valuable to me that, like, I'm in a position where I'm not going to take your money back. Then that, I have seen that work. But, you know, it's usually with somebody who was there at the beginning, you know, somebody in the first 5-10 employees who grows with you and then gets stuck, as opposed to if you bring in somebody from the outside, they got to go. Like, if you bring in somebody to be, like, your head of marketing, and you're like, okay, this person can't be the head of marketing because they just can't do the job, but, like, they're working their ass off, then that person, you just have to face facts, they're going to have to go. Mm-hmm. They're not a fit, and, like, for whatever reason, and that's that.
You, interesting, the way you laid this out in the book, take care of the people, the products, and the profits in that specific order. My question is, does that philosophy work for public and private companies?
I was public CEO, so yeah, no, like, so, and that's a great question. So I was public company CEO for 6.5 of the 8 years I ran the company, because I went public when I was 18 months old, which I do not recommend. That's a very bad idea, unless the alternative is going bankrupt, in which case it's a fabulous idea. And I think when you're public, it's even more important, because nobody on Wall Street ever says, how are your people doing? Are they motivated? Are they engaged? When they come to work, do they feel like they can make a contribution? And when they make that contribution, do they feel recognized for it? And does it advance the company's goals? Like, nobody on Wall Street ever asked me anything like that, ever. They don't give a fuck how your people are doing. They don't care. In fact, like, the less people, the better, because it means the more earnings. And the problem with that mentality, the Wall Street mentality, is it's a very, very short view on the world. So if you plan to run your company for, like, a year or 2 years, or you have some employment contract where you're just getting all the cash out and then running for the hills, then, you know, like, maybe that's good for you. But, like, if you're the founding CEO, this is your company, and you want to be around for, you know, 5, 10, 20 years, and you want to build something lasting and be able to look back and say, hey, I built that, like, we did something there, then it's going to be, like, the work that the people do in the company that creates the long-term profit, and, you know, the long-term products that create the long-term profit that are going to make you know, the guys on Wall Street and all the rest of the people happy. But nobody ever asks you about that. Like, this is not something that does. And so you got to not react. And everybody, like human beings, are like, they're very sensitive to like what's in their circle. Like if they hang out with a certain group, then their whole perspective changes and the prism they look through life is changes. And as CEO, like you're hanging out with people who have the wrong things in mind a lot because you have to. But you got to keep your priorities in order. And that's why, you know, that's why I kind of wrote it that way.
It's people, like products,
discipline and profits. That order.
Yesterday, you were quoted in the Wall Street Journal. You said that hip-hop artists make listeners feel their stories. How important, tell me the importance of storytelling in business.
So underrated. It's one of the most important things. And let me tell you why. When companies start to go astray, I'll tell you what the employees say. CEO doesn't say this. The management team doesn't say this. The employees say this. We have no strategy. We don't know where we're going. We don't know where we're headed. And you know what? Not only do the employees not know the strategy, investors don't know the strategy, customers don't know the strategy, and you know, new employees who you're trying to bring on, they don't hear the strategy. And what is the strategy? The strategy is a story. Like they're not actually different. Like people think there's some kind of like strategic planning exercise that you do, and like you get together and you get a bunch of guys from McKinsey or like Harvard MBAs and they draw on the board and then like, oh, that's a strategy. It's not the fucking strategy. The strategy is the story that you tell about like, why do we need to exist? Why does this company exist? Why are we in the world? The why. Like, why do we do what we do? Why is it important? That's the story. And if you can't tell that, and if you can't tell that in a massively compelling way, like, who's going to join you? Who's going to follow you? Who's going to go build it? Who's going to go do it? So, like, if you're a CEO and you're like, oh, I'm not very good at telling stories, like, that's not a good thing. That's, like, a very bad thing. You have to be, and look, the story doesn't have to come entirely from you. But you've got to be the keeper of the vision. You've got to be the one who says, okay, like, who are we? And you've got to get that out of the company if it's in the company, and you've got to make sure that it's articulated extremely well. And if you look at the great kind of CEOs in technology, they're all like quite good at this. Like you think Steve Jobs was no good at telling stories? You know, I got an argument with somebody on Twitter just like yesterday. They're like, oh no, it's all about the product. Storytelling doesn't matter. I'm like, you don't get to a good product if you can't tell a good story. It's part of it because you have to say like, why are we building this product? That's a story. And the story in good companies, the story and the strategy are identical. And one big mistake people make is they don't spend enough time working on the story of the company. You know, they neglect it. They say, I'm too busy for that. It's not something in my day. I'm taking incoming. Like people are calling me. I'm doing other people's agenda. I'm not doing my agenda. My agenda is like, I'm gonna explain to everyone why we're here and where we're going. And that's what CEOs do. And like, if you don't do that, you know, you're really not gonna be a very effective leader. So that it's a really, really important point. And it's it's one thing that you can get from you know, from guys like Nas, who can tell a story and can be extremely compelling. And in the Wall Street Journal article, you know, he made this album called Hip Hop is Dead, and then he had this song that was his closing argument called Hope. And in it, he didn't argue. He didn't, like, try and argue with you, like, why hip hop is dead or, like, what it used to be compared to what it is. He just went back and told a story about when he was 9 years old, what it was. And that was like the strongest argument he could have ever made. And that's what a story is about. It's something that everybody can connect to, where you get the emotional connection, you really feel why you're there. And then that's what makes people, you know, get up in the morning and go do stuff. Like that emotional connection to what you're talking about.
But I have to ask, if, you know, you built a great company, you sold it, went public, you have a very successful company now with your partner Mark Andreessen. You have a beautiful wife, family.
Thank you.
If you could do it all over again in business, what would you do differently?
That's a good question. Everything. So I made a lot of mistakes. So, for example, one mistake I made was in 2000, we had 600 employees and we were running out of space. And actually, the fire marshal came to the building and we're like, we're going to shut you down if you don't get some more space. And 2000, right? Like February 2000.
So February 2000, right? That's like the worst time in the history of .com. And yeah.
Well, the best time. it was just soon to be the worst time.
Temporarily the best time. And you have people in the hallways.
I've got people in the hallways. I've got, like, I'm blowing circuits because too much stuff is plugged into the wall. And so, you know, my CFO, and like, I've got everything going, you know, like the business is exploding. I'm like 6 months old and I do like a $20 million quarter. I mean, like, it's just crazy. It's bananas what's going on. And so my CFO comes to me and says, like, based on our growth plan, I think that we should get this lease in this building. Like, it's got plenty of room for us to grow. And, you know, it's going to be a $30 million commitment over the next 10 years. You know, I spent 5 minutes looking at it, and I was like, well, what do you think? And he's like, it's a good idea. And I'm like, okay, let's do it. Had I spent 15 minutes on that decision instead of 5 minutes on that decision, I would have kind of realized that as part of that $30 million 10-year commitment, like, it was a hard commitment in that I could not even use the cash. It was restricted. Like, so that cash kind of got locked into that deal. Well, 2 months later, the big .com crash. We stopped hiring. We couldn't move anybody into that building. The value, I paid $10 a square foot a month. Within 3 months, that real estate was going for 99 cents a square foot a month. That $30 million was gone. It was just gone. And had I spent 15 minutes on it, I would have made a better decision. And I made a lot of decisions like that. And that's why I got myself into so much trouble. So, like, be careful about doing what I did. But the thing it taught me was this. Look, as CEO, like, a very big product, what does a CEO do? Like, some people say, oh, the CEO is the number one salesman, or the CEO is, like, bullshit. Like, the CEO is the CEO. You know, like, hire your salesperson to be the number one salesman. Like, not that you don't have to sell, not that you don't have to have a story, but the thing the CEO's got to do is they've got to deliver very high quality decisions at a very high rate of speed. Like, that is what the company expects. And if you don't decide, the company freezes. And if you don't decide correctly, the company dies. And so how do you do that? And in order to do that, you have got to have the knowledge. You have to know what's going on. You've got to pay attention. And you've got to go get that knowledge before that decision comes to you. So you've got to go, you've got to spend enough time with your people to go, like, you're talking to an engineer, you've got to go, okay, like, what is hard about your job? What's in your way? Like, what's good and what's frustrating you? And understand, like, what's going on in the code base? What are the tools we're using? How is that working? You got to talk to your finance people, like, what are you worried about? What's going on? Because you've got to start processing these things before they come to you, because by the time they hit your desk, by the time it's like, we got to decide, Ben, like, are we going to get shut down by the fire marshal, or are you going to, like, open up this new space? Like, you don't have time to make the decision. And if you don't have time, like, you could get it wrong. And if you get it wrong, like, you may lose your company. You may spend $30 million on some real estate that you can't ever use and don't ever need. And that's well, that's one of the mistakes. I made a lot of mistakes. But, you know, but the thing is, there's only one mistake that you can't make as CEO, and that's running out of cash. That's the one unforgivable sin. And so one thing you get, and you'll get a lot of advice on money. Like, when things are like this, venture capitalists will go, oh, spend, like, have a good time, baby. You know what my VC said to me? He said, Ben, you need to figure out what you're going to do if capital, imagine if capital were free. And I thought, what the fuck does that mean? What if capital is free? Like, free, it doesn't even make sense. But then it was kind of like I was like a five-year-old, and my brother said, hey, what would you do if, like, candy had the same nutritional value as broccoli? I'd eat a lot of candy. And so these are the kinds of pieces of advice that you're going to get. But the one thing you cannot do is run out of cash, because once you run out of cash, it's game over. And so the thing that is most important, the one mistake that you can never, ever, 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 ever make is to have no money. And this is another reason why storytelling is important, because, like, if you can tell a story, sometimes you can get more money. And I always like to say my two core competencies are fundraising and PR. And they're both very story-oriented, so. I would take too long to go through all the mistakes.
All right, that's one of them. At this point in the
session. No regrets, but lots of mistakes.
No regrets. At this point in the session, I'd like to open up the room for Q&A.
Good to see you again.
Yeah, good to see you
too. Just do me a favor, could you state your name and...
That's Sergey.
Yeah, okay.
I saw him yesterday. So, good to see you.
Just a quick question. What are the right reasons to persevere in continuing with a startup or a product? And what are the wrong reasons to persevere with a particular startup or product?
Look, the general mentality that you have to have is that you're going to find a way. And you know, it depends a little on the stage of the company. So look, if you're two people and you build something and you go, oh, everybody's going to love this thing, and then nobody uses it, and you go, you know, like that whole thing was wrong, then like that's fine to give up on. If you've got like 50 people and you know, you've convinced them all to join, and like you built something and it's not going quite as you planned, that really is not a reason to quit. You kind of have to find the answer. You've got to find, you know, a lot of what people depend on you for as a leader is you've got to find the move. And in business, the thing about business that's interesting is like, and one of the reasons I admire Steve so much is there's always a move. You may not see it, but I guarantee you it's out there. Like there's always a way, there's always a place that you can go with almost anything that you're doing where you can make progress and you can drive it forward. And the key is to find it before you run out of time and run out of money. And that's not always easy, but the very best leaders don't get caught up in the failure they're having. They get focused on the move they're about to make to get them out of the failure that they're having. And that's the, you know, that's one of the biggest things. And there's a line in the book that I have, like, you know, chances are you're dead. And that happened to me, man, like, chances are I was dead. Like, if you did the calculation and the probabilities, would we survive? It's like, you know, chances are you're absolutely dead. But you can't play statistics when you're CEO. You have to play calculus. You have to find the answer. You've got to, you know, you have to believe there's a right answer, and you've got to go find it. And that's, like, what you're there for. And if you don't think you can find the right answer, don't start a fucking company and get all these people to join you, because, like, you have no right to do that. Yes. Yes, sir. In front row.
I don't have the mic, but I can speak loud.
Yeah, just
okay.
Yeah.
Hi there.
And your name?
My name is Shaz.
All right, Shaz.
Just a question I have was, when would you suggest an entrepreneur who's trying to facilitate growth for his company go get a line of credit at a bank or go raise cash from a VC?
Well, it depends on, okay. So, if what you're trying to build is something that is going to be a very large business that's, you know, you think is going to serve people globally and be extremely valuable one day and so forth, then it's very likely that venture capital is a more appropriate way to go, because with venture capital, you have the ability, businesses like that tend to take a lot of cash to not necessarily build in a vacuum, but build in a competitive environment. So, you know, you may get out there, but you've got to be kind of, you have to capture the market. Like, it's not just enough, and this is one of the things that I think is screwed up in the entrepreneurial culture, is people think, oh, I just built a great product and like everybody's gonna come buy it. That's not the way the world works. You have to go take the market. You can build a great product, but you gotta go take the market. And to take the market often costs money. And there's no more money behind like a line of credit from a bank. There's not like, okay, got $1 million and now I'm gonna go get $50 million, but in venture capital you can go do that. So if you're building something that you think could be worth billions of dollars, then for sure venture capital. On the other hand, if you say, look, I've got this thing and I'm building it to have a business and it's gonna be me and like three of my buddies and we're gonna build it and it's gonna generate plenty of cash for us to live the way we wanna live and it's gonna be great and we're gonna really focus on the customers we have, but we're not trying to be Google, like that's not what we're about. Then a line of credit might make more sense where, you know, if you've got things you can collateralize and borrow against or what have you, then that might be an appropriate route because like why give up equity in the company? Why give up ownership at that point?
Personal guarantees?
Yeah, no. Okay, so that's one thing, look.
Well, I just wanted to make sure that we were clear here.
Yeah. Do not go start a business on personally guaranteed loans. And let me tell you why. If you're gonna do something like that, go ahead. Like if you're putting your money in, you gotta be careful with that anyway, but if you're putting your money in, you get equity. You own that business, that's what you want. You don't guarantee loans, you don't do stuff like that because one, you're taking risk, you're not getting rewarded appropriately enough for the risk you're taking. And then secondly, don't cause yourself to have a psychological meltdown. You guys chuckle, like half of, maybe 90% of what Steve and I have gone through is like just not having a psychological meltdown. Because there's like tremendous pressure when you're trying to do this. There's a lot of people depending on you and like you get into trouble. And like you don't need to be in that kind of trouble and like personal bankruptcy kind of trouble. Like that's too much trouble. Like at some point, like you've got to stop the madness and do not like say, oh, well, like we're gonna borrow this money and I'll personally guarantee it, but I know it's gonna turn out well. Don't plan your company for it turning out well. You've got to, as CEO, you plan for when it goes badly. When you hire somebody, it's like, can this person help me out when things are like, when I'm dying? Not like, is this person gonna be great when like I'm Facebook? Because anybody will be great if you're Facebook.
So I'm Nina and I work here at General Assembly. And I work with a lot of, and I interact with a lot of first-time entrepreneurs. So I'm curious to hear from you. If you were to suggest four things that entrepreneurs need to like really be well-versed in, whether it's knowledge or skills-based, what would you say they need to be well-versed in?
Four things. Are you sure you don't want three things?
Or two things. Four things.
So, like, if it's skills that you need training in, like, so for sure, storytelling. Like, I think that being good, and this is actually the one skill that I think people learn at Y Combinator, just in my observations of VC, like, those guys are actually pretty good at teaching storytelling, and Paul himself is a phenomenal storyteller, and so that's just a very valuable skill. It helps you raise money, it helps you recruit talent, it helps you do everything. I think the other skills are really kind of leadership and management skills, and it's a set of things. It's why would someone want to follow you? And it has to do with, and it's kind of a little bit of skill and more who you are. So for example, if you're all about you, why would I want to follow you? Because there's nothing in it for me. And so that's just something that I think a lot of young entrepreneurs don't understand. But when you're young, you understand this less than when you get older. And so you just have to like look at the world through the perspective of the people who are going to be working in your company, not always through your perspective. So I would say like the two things that are probably most important are the ability to articulate where you're going and what your vision is, and two, the ability to understand where other people are coming from and what their needs are and what their kind of goals and desires are. And if you have those two things, I think you'd be on to a pretty good start. So I think that's what I would
say. I'd like to add Identifying talent, I think, is an important skill that makes an important difference, obviously, when you're building a business. And the perseverance to stay the course, because it's not going to be all good. That's the only certainty that you have. I mean, it's not certain that it's going to fail. It's not certain it's not going to be successful. But it's certainly, even in success, not going to always be good. So perseverance is a very, very important thing that you got to have. You could be talented and have management skills and not have perseverance. When I first started my business, I specifically remember a guy that I'd known for years who had went to University of Pennsylvania, and then he went to Carnegie Mellon, and a really smart business guy and could figure everything out. But as soon as it got water got deep, he didn't have any perseverance. And you know, at that young age of 27 to 28, he went right back into a job and started telling me about, you know, something that made no sense at the time, but that's what he wanted to do, because he wasn't ready for deep water. By the way, you know, it sounds really cool to be an entrepreneur, but not everybody can deal with being an entrepreneur, saying anything wrong about somebody, but some people don't like riding roller coasters either, right? We all have different thresholds for pain, and being an entrepreneur and building a business certainly has this level of pain. And if you just focus on the upside and don't focus on the process, you may think that you are ready to deal with that when you don't even have the persona and personality to deal with the risks involved.
Yeah. Actually, I want to tell a little story off that, because I haven't even told Steve this story, but it's a great story, so it popped into my head and you guys want to hear it. So Steve mentioned identifying talent, and one of the interesting things about that is, for those of you who haven't followed his career, it's one of the things that he's done better than almost anybody. And one of the kind of first stories of it was he discovered a rapper by the name of Nas years ago, based on a song that he performed on a record called Live at the Barbecue. And like Steve went out and found Nas, and Nas ended up being considered, you know, by many the greatest lyricist of all time. And I was talking to Nas the other day, and I forgot what we were talking about, but I said, you know, like, Nas, you have a nose for talent. He's like, Ben, you noticed that. You know, I discovered Steve. Which I thought was very funny.
So, actually, unfortunately, we ran out of time for any other questions, because we have a book signing for the next 30 minutes. So we're gonna
sneak in your questions during the book signing.
Yes,
it always works.
Thank you both so much.
Okay. Thank you guys.